I would like for you to imagine a Unitarian church service. It's a church service with no joys and sorrows, no singing of shalom at the end, and no lighting of the chalice. Anybody uncomfortable yet? I'm just getting started. Because those are the least significant changes. I want you to imagine a Unitarian church where the morning service lasts 2.5 hours. Yes, I said the morning service, because there's also an afternoon service that lasts for an additional 2 hours. The sermons at those services are each about 1.5 hours length. And those sermons, by the way, they never contain humor or stories or personal anecdotes. They're pretty dry. And there's also no religious education. Children are expected to sit and listen for about 4.5 hours each Sunday. In the Unitarian Church service, I'm asking you to imagine all readings come from the Bible, and there is never any positive mention of the other major world religions. And in this Unitarian Church, the only person who is allowed to speak is the minister, and the only people who are allowed to become ministers are white men. And what about the congregation? In this Unitarian church service, there are still pews, but there's also assigned seating. The cushioned pews in the front, towards the front, are reserved for the wealthy members of the congregation. The hard wood pews behind those are reserved for the middle class, and poor people have to stand in the back or sit in the balcony. Who here feels a little uncomfortable with what I've just described? So what I've just described to you is a typical Unitarian church service in the 1840s. Thank goodness for change, right? From then to now, our congregations have gone through changes and more changes and even more changes on top of those changes. From an historical perspective, none of those changes, no matter how small or how large, how trivial or how significant, were unanimously embraced. Often the changes, whatever they were met with fear, resistance, and sometimes even outright conflict. We can't possibly do away with the segregated seating by class, said perhaps a member of the finance committee. What's that going to do to our budget? We can't light a chalice, said someone in the 1980s. We don't worship symbols. We can't sing Spirit of Life, said someone in 1993. It's unfamiliar, and besides, it doesn't even rhyme. How do you even do a hymn that doesn't even rhyme? I can say with pride that our denomination became the first to ordain women, that was the 1860s, and the first to openly ordain, or to ordain openly gay and lesbian ministers in the 1970s. Those changes, we embraced changes that other religious groups still have not embraced today. But it's also the truth that those changes were not accepted unanimously. That there was resistance to every change. Change is hard. I'm glad that here in this church, we have never had our disagreements about things like joys and sorrows and singing shalom. Or so I've heard. That was actually before my time, but I've heard a thing or two about it. Think back to the 1840s, that church that I just described. Way back in the 1840s, a Unitarian minister named Theodore Parker preached a sermon called The Transient and the Permanent, The Changing and the Unchanging. He began his sermon with a history lesson. Parker said that over the 1800 years of Christianity, just about everything had changed, even things deemed fundamentally essential. Yesterday's heresy has become today's orthodoxy. He said, things that people were once burned at the stake for professing They are now punished for denying. And then Parker drops a bombshell. He said that everything about the church as it is today, all of the forms, no matter how beautiful or beloved in our hearts, they're all transient, not permanent. They're all going to change. Everything is going to change, he said. Parker said it's perfectly fine to love the forms we find in religion, doctrine, styles of worship, symbols, and so on and so forth. But when we regard those things as permanent, when we insist that they must never change, he said it's then that we fall into a trap and that we actually damage those things. His sermon, by the way, so shocked the Unitarians of his day that he was shunned by his fellow ministers. They turned their backs on him and broke off relationship with him. And of course, they were all wrong, and Parker was right. All the things that Parker said would change did change. Did I ever tell you about a bumper sticker I once saw? It was one of those I heart bumper stickers. You know those bumper stickers that people put on their car? I heart dogs, I heart cats. You know what I'm talking about, right? Only this bumper sticker read as follows. I heart the Book of Common Prayer 1928 edition. The bumper sticker is a reference to the Episcopalian Church, which in 1979 released a new version of the Book of Common Prayer, which had last been revised 50 years previously in 1928. This person's bumper sticker was a protest. I saw this sticker on a car, though, in 2012, 33 years after those 1979 revisions had been published. And so I imagine, you know, I didn't talk with the person, but I kind of could imagine that this person was still so against those changes that had happened 33 years previously that they put a bumper sticker on their car to protest it. And part of me wonders, back in 1928, did anyone put a sticker on their horse and buggy that read, I heart the Book of Common Prayer, 1896 revision? And it's not just Episcopalians. I've met Catholics who think that Vatican II was a big mistake. And I have even met Unitarian Universalists who still disagree with the 1961 decision to merge the Unitarians and the Universalists. Change is hard. So where am I going with this? Some of you may be wondering. Well, those of you who are more change-averse can exhale a great big sigh of relief. I'm not about to announce major news. I'm not about to proclaim some brand new direction that we ought to go. I'm not about to lay out some multiple-point plan of things that I think need to be changed. The anxiety in the room just went down a little bit. I have to tell you, I like singing Shalom. All the time. I like joys and sorrows. Almost all the time. Now it's time for those of you who are like the change people, the people who are like, yes, change, you guys, it's your turn to get angry at me now. It's impossible to please everyone. But here's the thing. My sermon this morning is actually not about this church, even though all I've talked about is church stuff so far. My sermon this morning is not about church, really. Congregations, I believe, are just really good laboratories for experimenting with being human. Congregations are really good laboratories for experimenting with being human. They're really good places for trying out change and even transformation. Church is a place where we can try out leadership. You can lead a covenant group or teach a class. You can be asked to serve on the board, even if you've never previously served on a nonprofit board. You can try out for the musical, even if you feel like you can't sing or dance, and certainly not both at the same time. You can take the preaching practicum, even if you are deathly afraid of public speaking. And convenient that I mentioned the preaching practicum because it just so happens that we have an extra spot in it that I'm trying to fill in the next couple of weeks. It's a place where we can try spiritual practices that are new to us, where we can learn to ask for help or learn to offer help, where we can grow, whether that's in maturity or patience or generosity or gratitude or compassion or all of those. It's a place where we can face our changes, the changes happening in our own life, whether that's changes in health or changes in relationship or changes in work. It's a place where we can even face our own mortality, that most significant of changes. Congregations are good laboratories, aren't they? And here's the thing about being a good laboratory. I'd like for all of the scientists in the room to raise your hand. Amy, you should both serve because you raised your hand. So, scientists, you can tell me if I'm right here. When you do an experiment, you always get the results you were expecting to get, right? Right? No, but you always learn something, even if what you learn is like not to do that mistake that you made that you'll fix next time. Congregations are human laboratories, and there are occasional fires, mistakes, sometimes even explosions. Sometimes the things we mix together don't react and it's a dud. Sometimes we get exactly the results we were hoping for, and sometimes we get surprised, and what happens is something we never expected in our wildest dreams. Someone once said that every minister has one sermon that they just preach variations of, speaking of Beethoven's variations. I'd like to know who said that because I don't agree with it. But I think if that saying were true, if I had only one sermon, it would probably go like this. This is good, and it will change. This is bad, and it will change. This is good, and it will change. That's the hard part. We'll do the hard part first. Late UU minister Forrest Church said, "Religion is our human response to being alive and having to die. This is good, and it will change." Part of being human is that tough and sad and painful things happen to us. We suffer. We lose those whom we love and those who love us. Our bodies go through a process resembling entropy. All our lives we go through changes, and those changes are often leaving something that is good for something that is unknown. The poet Mary Oliver puts it starkly in her poem, Poppies. "Of course, nothing stops the cold, black, curved blade from hooking forward. Of course, loss is the great lesson. This is good, and it will change. And just about everything in our lives that is good is also transient." Again, the words of Mary Oliver. To live in this world, you must be able to do three things. To love what is mortal. To hold it against your bones, knowing your own life depends on it. And when the time comes to let it go. To let it go. There's another side of change, though, because it's not just good things. The people we love, our sources of comfort and joy that are transient. It also turns out that bad things are not permanent either. This is bad, and it can change. Isn't that good news? Liberating news? Think of it this way. Every powerful empire, the most powerful empire in the world, has fallen. The Roman Empire collapsed. The sun sets on the British Empire many times a day. The Berlin Wall was torn down. Change does not just mean good things coming to an end, but also that bad may give way to good. Slavery ended on our continent. Apartheid ended in South Africa. Marriage equality became the law of the land. And those are at the global and societal level, at the personal and community level. I want to suggest that there is always, at the personal and community level, there is always some change for the better happening around us. There's changes for the worse, but there's also those others. Of course, it's not just enough to sit back and hope that bad things change. Change does not happen magically, but only through concerted effort and dedication. This is good, and it will change. This is bad, and it can change. There will come a time, maybe in a year, maybe in a decade, maybe in 100 years, when Unitarian Universalists will no longer sing Spirit of Life. The hymn may start to sound passé and fall out of favor. The words, we may wake up some morning and decide those words are dated. Or musically, it won't carry the power that it once did. But it will give way in popularity to some other song that we like even more. It may happen during our lifetime, it may not. But that is fine. It's how it is supposed to be. And it is good. The most important thing is just to keep singing. Amen. Blessed be. And let's keep singing. Our closing hymn this morning, we've picked one of those newfangled hymns with syncopation and things like that. So I want from the evil teal hymnal, joking, invite you to rise in body or in spirit and join us in our closing hymn this morning. 1024, when the Spirit says do, listen, because I'll call out some prompts. Thank you.